यूनिवर्सिटी ऑफ राजस्थान जयपुर मॉड्यूल 30 लेट मिंग पेंटिंग ड्यूरिंग द लेट मिंग डायनेस्टी देयर वर नंबर ऑफ गिफ्टेड एंड ओरिजिनल पेंटर्स ऑफ फिगर सब्जेक्ट्स तांगियन चियू यिंग वर अमंग देम हिसु वी टोंग ची चियांग चाओ टुसु टिंग युंग पेन चाओ पोचू चेन होंग शू शुन को हुंग were painters who painted landscapes in the archaic style. The type painted by Tang and Shung dynasty, the proliferation of separate stylistic currents or schools of painting in the late Ming dynasty is one of the many astonishing features of that fascinating period. After a short period of firm and stable government in the later part of the 15th century, the Ming regime had begun to sink slowly into decay. The emperors were mostly weak and dissipated, helpless in the hands of Enchus, who controlled both court and the government. The dynasty survived until 1644 through its own Eretia, but the loyalty of the intelligentsia upon whom it depended for its existence was strained to breaking point. Many scholars retired altogether from public life or formed secret resistance groups such as the famous Tunglin Society. They tried to uphold the true Confucian ideals, while those who served at the court were tainted with its corruption. This conviction among retired scholars that they were the true custodians of the traditional culture had produced influence upon the character of the scholarly painting during the 16th and 17th centuries. At the same time, the gradual breakdown of Ming society and the withdrawal of the scholars led to fragmentation of the tradition of literary painting. The acceptance of tradition was found in artists of the late Ming period. During the late Ming dynasty, there were a number of gifted and original painters of figure subjects, quite unlike the charming creations of Tang Yin and Chiu Ying. For example, Ting Yun Peng, active about 1584 to 1638, was noted for pictures of Buddhist and Taoist personages. The Dragon King paying homage to Gunyan is a hanging scroll of 17th century belonging to Kansas City. In this painting, he not only revived the orthodox liner technique of the Shung master Li Lungmin, but also captured some of the eccentricity of early Zen painters. From this time onward, the tendency to look to the past became more and more characteristic of Chinese painting. Men thought wistfully of the great days of the Tang and Shung dynasties and were never tired of looking at paintings in which the heroic past was recreated. The gorgeous decorative blue, green and white landscapes of the 12th century court painter Chao Po Chu and his school was often copied or imitated. Typical of such copies is the Boston hand scroll, the entry of the first Han emperor into Quan Chung. The greatest late Ming figure painter to draw upon archaic styles was Chen Hongshao. Born in Chekiang province, he painted from boyhood, developing an accomplished technique and a very individual manner based in a curious way on antique styles. While his fame reached the Ming Emperor, he was invited to Peking court, where he served a short term around the year 1640 in an official position, although not as a court painter proper. In 1642, he was nominated to the Academy of Learning and accepted, but declined the rank of painter in attendance that was also offered to him. He received an official appointment just before the fall of the Ming Dynasty, only to be taken prisoner in Nanking by the advancing Manchus. His life was spared and he returned to his hometown, Chekiang, where he died soon after in 1652. The figure painters on whom he modeled his style were Chin Hussein, Li Lung Min, and Chen Hong Shao. His hand scroll depicts screens from the life of the 4th century poet Tao Yuan Ming, dated to 1650, Academy of Arts, Honolulu, Hawaii. In the painting, the poet mediates kneeling upon palm leaf beside a rock on which repose his two fans, his brush and his inkstone. Above him are written relevant passages from the poem. Chen was a highly talented person. In his hands, archaic styles and techniques were not only brought back to life, but were transformed into something new. His other creation is Boating on the Lake. It is an album leaf, ink and color on paper, and in the J.P. Dubose collection, Lugano. He has simply drawn hills seen across the water are quoted from Tung landscape. The melancholy lady gazes from an upstairs window recalls the themes of many poignant Tung poems. Chen Hong Shao was best known for his figure painting, most of them imaginary portraits and representations of historical or Buddhist subjects. Outstanding among these is a hand scroll illustrating the long poem titled Homecoming Ode of Tao Yuan Ming. It is a section of a hand scroll, ink and light colors on silk, and at present in the collection of Honolulu Academy of Arts. A 4th century poet, Tao was fond of wine, musing and chrysanthemum. He is shown enjoying all the three in the first section of Chen's scroll. Seated on a rock, he inhales the fragrance of a bunch of his favorite flowers. His lute beside him and a bowl of wine on a flat stone in front. For the costume of the figure, Chen has returned to the stylistic stage of the Ku Kai Chi painting when drapery was drawn with continuous lineament in long curves and revealed little about the body beneath. Husu Wei was like Tang Yin, a child prodigy, showing outstanding literary ability by the time he was 10. He rose rapidly to prominence because he was secretary to an ambitious governor. But for political intrigue, the governor was imprisoned. Khusu feared for his own life and pretended madness. He escaped prison, but for murdering his second wife, he attempted suicide while in prison, but was unsuccessful, and his friend got him released. He then returned to his home in Chikyang. His explosive studies of bamboo, that is a section of a hand scroll, painted ink on paper and at present in the Freer Gallery of Art, Washington, D.C. is worth mentioning, which he painted in a state of high intoxicant. He drank to excess, managed a precarious living by selling his painting and calligraphy. As written in his biography, nobody liked him and he died penniless at the age of 73. Whitman was active about 1591 to 1626. His most original works were his fantastically contorted ink landscapes, his delightfully detailed panorama, Greeting the Spring, is dated to 1600. It is a section of a hand scroll, ink and color on paper, belonging to Ming Dynasty and at present in the Cleveland Museum of Art, Ohio. It has much of tradition, even of archaism, in its precise drawing and gay color. Yet even here, there are willful distortions, such as the fantastic rock overhanging the village on the left. Nominally, it represents a spring fertility ritual of ancient origin, the landscape ranging from calm waterways bordered by tranquil willows to a high mountains darkly reaching beyond the upper edges of the scroll. The color is structured rather than decorated. Whitman's another painting, The 500 Arhats. It is a section of a hand scroll, ink on light color on paper. It belongs to Ming Dynasty and is at present in the Cleveland Museum of Art, Ohio. This shows the master of fine line, Bai Mio figure painting. Hundreds of figure throng the hand scroll. Scholars traveling the mountains or groups of festive townsmen. Sun Ko Hung, an older contemporary and a friend of Tung Chi Chang, who is classed with Tung in the Hung Ting School, named after the town Su Chau, where they both lived. He was a scholar, collector, and an antiquarian in whose life painting played a smaller part than it did in Tung Chi Chang's. His hand scroll, made up of 20 scenes, represents the moon rises from elegant diversions for leisure hours. It is a section of a hand scroll, ink and light colors on paper, Palace Museum Collection, Taichung. This illustrates once more how a poetic sensibility can compensate for the lack of any great technical proficiency. Shun Ko Hung, without the temperament to understand the grand explorations of the major individualist masters, nevertheless joins in the experimental spirit of the age to develop a personal manner reminiscent of the color woodcut, combining heavy line with pale flat washes of color. In the section titled The Moon Rises, the cool tones of early evening moonlight on the trunks of the wutung trees and on the rocks are admirably suggested, although not by any means accurately reproduced, despite some obvious influence of Shen Chao in style and theme, the picture as a whole seems strikingly fresh and original. Chang Feng, he flourished from 1645 to 1673. Much is less known about Chang Feng, partly because he was never so famous as Hu Su Vi, but also because his was a less colorful and eventful life, and so less rewarding for the chronosailer. He was a minor official until the fall of the Ming, but then, like so many late Ming intellectuals, retired into semi-poverty to avoid serving the Manchus. Noblemen and high dignitaries entertained him in the hope of being presented with one of his landscapes or figure pictures. He lived in peace with everybody, never showing bad temper, because he was by nature very retiring. Says one writer, he found satisfaction within himself. His hanging scrawl, gazing at a red-leafed maple across a ravine, is dated to 1660. Ink and light colors on paper, and at present in the collection of Yamato Bunkan Khan, Osaka, shows that the artist, in fact, more or less irrelevant to his work. But the Chinese critics' contention was exactly the opposite. A man cannot apply brush to a paper, they believed, without revealing something of his innermost self. Without revealing something of his innermost self. Even a more professional painter like Lan Ying, who worked from 1585 and after 1600, who came from Chekiang, is difficult to fit into any particular school. This panorama hand scroll of Fuchun Mountains was inspired, like so many renderings of his subjects, by the famous hand scroll dwelling in Fuchu Mountains of the Yuan scholar painter Huang Kong Wang. But Lan Ying has added color and rather harshly angular forms of his mountains reveal the influence not merely the Qi school of his home province, but of the restless age in which he was living. Sheng Mao Yi, Jui Tu and Xiao Mi were other late Ming expressionists whose originality is now becoming recognized. One of the groups of late Ming literati became known as the Hua Tsing School, after the hometown in Jiangsu of several of its most prominent members. These included Ku Ching Ai, who had great influence on the painter critic Tung Chi Chang, Shun Ko Hung, a lyrical and scholarly landscape akin to Shen Chao and Chao Tsu. Tung Chi Chang, a watershed figure of late Ming Chinese painting, who dramatically changed to the course of Chinese landscape painting. Dominating the age stands the imposing figure of Tung Chi Chang of late Ming literati. None was more influential than him. Painter, calligrapher, scholar, critic, and collector. He became the figurehead and spokesman for the intellectuals of his time. As a critic, he is chiefly known to codify painting styles and classify the old masters according to his famous system of the northern and southern schools of landscape painting. According to him, all the scholar painters, bamboo painters, and painters of monochrome ink landscapes in a free style based on Tung Yuan and the masters of the Yuan dynasty belong to a southern tradition. Professionals, court painters and decorators and members of the Qi school were contemptuously relegated to a northern school. This theory gained wide acceptance among literati because it fitted their own ideals and prejudices. At the same time, the suggestion of a we and they group gave comfort and encouragement to scholars who felt that their talents were unwanted and unappreciated by the emperor. Although Tung Chi Chang himself did not invent the theory, but took it over and developed it from an idea of his friend Mo Xing Lung, such was his authority that the three-century scholar painters continued to see the history of landscape painting through his eyes. They often painted in the manner of Tung Yuan or Huang Kung Wang, and it was Tung Chi Chang version of these styles that guided them. For many of them, nature ceased to provide the inspiration. Painting becomes the branch of historical scholarship. It is often impossible to understand works of these painters without knowing from whom, as it were, they are quoting and without recognizing the pictorial and stylistic illusions in each work. The intensely intellectual character of such painting is best seen in his work himself. His landscape with a straw hut was painted in 1597 for Chen Chi Ju, a young scholar whom he greatly admired. The forms of the mountains with the long hemp fiber texture strokes are derived from Huang Kung Wang, but there is deliberate distortion in Tung Chi Chang's painting that expresses the cool, intellectual passion of the scholar and theorist rather than a poet's response to the natural world. Autumn landscape, hanging scroll, ink and light colors on silk, Nu Wa Chai collection, Munich. Here in this painting, he submits nature to the same kind of systemization. He observes, analyzes, compares it with the visions of earlier artists, borrows what he pleases from them, but in the end, reorganizes the visual material according to his personal principles. This is one of his finest paintings. Where he tries to use the standard of Neet Tissand compositional formula. His importance and the extent of influence are comparable to Caravaggio in European painting. The two men incidentally were active at about the same time. In short, he attempted to bring the whole history and art of painting into a state of order, satisfactory to himself and convincing to his contemporaries. He succeeded so well that most books about painting written in China after his time are strongly under his influence.